Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome to Worship with the Village Church on this last Sunday of January in 2021. As we settle in to worship the Lord, let me remind you that you may be in touch with us to communicate your prayer concerns or simply to visit about other issues important to you or to send in your financial support to the church through the addresses that are printed on your screen. The Super Bowl is coming, and I'm not actually referring to the football version, but to the soup version of the Super Bowl. It's been our custom for many years now, following the lead of a Presbyterian youth group about 30 years ago, to collect cans of soup around Super Bowl Sunday in order to help support the supplies of local food banks. And so, starting next Saturday at 10 to noon, you may drop off cans of soup or cases of soup or even loads of cash, and we'll go buy the soup for you. You can continue to bring your soup through our worship services, including our Ash Wednesday gatherings that will be held on February 17th. For Ash Wednesday, the beginning of Lent, we will have from 3 until 5 in the afternoon several prayer stations where you may come and pray and then receive ashes as a way of beginning the season of penitence and renewal and forgiveness that is marked by the season of Lent. So we'll start that season with our Ash Wednesday worship as well online. And in the midst of that, at the beginning of that, we'll be collecting soup to help out the hungry in our community. I'll remind you that all of our adult Bible studies have now resumed, but it's not too late to join in on any of them. Our Sunday morning group is studying the book of Exodus under the leadership of Bill Hohen. Our Monday evening group is studying the parables of Jesus under the leadership of Laura Metzger. And our weekday La Costa Glen women's and men's groups are studying the book of Romans under the leadership of our different pastors. Next Sunday, February 7th, Neil Pressa will lead a Zoom seminar that will introduce new members to the life of the church or simply be a good way for those who are thinking about joining to become acquainted with our church as you think about your participation with us. So give Neil an email and let him know you would like to be part of that. Our backdrop today is a wonderful arrangement of beautiful flowers from Third Bloom, the local Rancho Santa Fe florist. I'd remind you that you can honor someone that you love or remember someone that you love by providing these flowers for our Sunday worship. And you can email Holly Crawford to learn more about how that happens. We also have three roses with us today that celebrate the birth recently of three grandchildren into our church family. One is for Orion Hawkins, the grandchild of the McNeils. One is for Everett Stammer, the grandchild of the Schraders. And one is for Wiley Joliet, the grandson of the Barclays. And so we're celebrating the births of these three children into our broader church community today. And finally, I have a sculpture that is four angels standing together holding hands, something that Helen and I have had for many years. For us, it's a beautiful symbol of the unity and the community that we will all share together, hopefully here on earth, but then certainly in heaven as we're gathered together. We'll be talking more about that a little bit later in our worship. Well, let's take just a few moments then to begin again to focus, to open our hearts, to center our souls, and to invite the Lord to be with us and to speak with us as we are called together to worship in these words from Psalm 133. How very good and pleasant it is when kindred live together in unity. It is like the precious oil on the head running down upon the beard, on the beard of Aaron, running down over the collar of his robes. It is like the dew of Hermon, which falls on the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord ordained his blessing, life forevermore. Friends, let's worship God.
God so loved us that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, for the life of the world. It is in that promise, in that truth, in that reality that we can come before God, confessing our sins, confessing the ways in which we need God's mercies and grace. Let us join our hearts together in confessing together. Creating and redeeming God, you call us to follow you, and each day you fill us with the power of your Spirit. We are given your courage and yet act with caution and timidity. We know your intentions for justice, yet too often keep silent or yield to the complexity of issues and do nothing. We are overwhelmed with your love, yet are hesitant to mention your name to another. We have been forgiven much, yet we harbor old resentments, hold on to past hurts, and turn away from reconciliation. Forgive us, Lord, for we have sinned. Set our faces to your forgiveness and our hands to your work, that we might be your light to the world. In the assurance of your mercy, we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, sisters, and brothers in Christ and people of God, hear and receive, believe, and trust in the good news of God in Jesus Christ, that God in Jesus Christ loved us, that he gave his Son Jesus Christ in his life, death, resurrection, and ascension. We have been redeemed, we have been saved, we have been reconciled in Christ and to one another. Thanks be to God. And everyone says, Amen. May the peace of Jesus Christ be with you. Because God has given us peace with him and with one another, let us share signs of God's love and peace with each other. I encourage and invite you to do so with those that are with you, those that are around you. And not only this day, but every day, share the signs of God's love and peace with a world that so desperately needs it. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you. each other. We will walk hand in hand. We will walk with each other. We will walk hand in hand. And together we'll spread the news that God is in our land. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will work with each other. Side by side, we will work with each other. We will work side by side, and we'll guard each one's dignity and save each one's pride. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. And all praise to Christ Jesus, His only Son. And all praise to the Spirit who makes us one. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
Good morning, children. I hope that you are all having a great Sunday morning. We are here to dive back into your kids' message. So go ahead and pull out those Bibles that you have at home, and you can follow along with me as I read your verse for this morning. Your verse comes from Ephesians 4:29, and I'm going to read it from my Bible that I have here in our classroom at the church. But it's such a great way for us to practice where to find certain verses by pulling them out every Sunday morning. And then that way, when you're going throughout your week and you need something to go back and reference, now you know where to find all the verses that I'm reading. So go ahead and pull out your Bibles and turn to Ephesians 4:29. Your verse for this morning says, "Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen." We're ending this month from this verse because this is such a great way to wrap up our theme, which has been responsibility. It's our responsibility to not let any unwholesome talk or bad words come out of our mouth, because that doesn't make people feel better. This verse is telling us that doesn't build them up to feel good about what we're saying to them. God wants us to hold Him in our hearts, and then that way the things that come out of our mouths honor and glorify Him. That is your reminder for this morning. Again, we're wrapping up January and we're moving into February next week. So if you haven't submitted your addresses to our children's ministries, go ahead and have your parents do that this morning. And then that way we can make sure that you receive one of our Valentine's bags that we're putting together for you all. We hope that you enjoy receiving these bags at your homes, and we look forward to seeing you back here next week for the month of February. Bye-bye.
Father in heaven, holy is your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Our Father in heaven, lead us not into temptation, but God, deliver us from the enemy. Yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Give us this moment all that we need, and forgive us our sins as we forgive the ones who have sinned against us. Our Father in heaven, lead us not into temptation, but God, deliver us from the enemy. Yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.
Essential in worship, both in praise and in supplication. I'm going to lead us in a pastoral prayer and then invite you to join me in the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. O Lord, we lift up our prayers to you, for you are the mighty and everlasting God, God whom we call Father. Guide us by your Holy Spirit as we come before your throne of grace. God, keep us directed in our prayers to pray the heart of Jesus, taking away personal agendas from our lips, any malice, posturing, or attitudes that hurt the witness and name of our Savior and Lord. Oh Lord, help us to be a people unified in Christ Jesus, modeling for neighbors, friends, community, governing entities, and for the world what unity in Christ means. We are the workers that you sent out to the harvest. Let us mend brokenness in love, holding together peace, hope, faith, and generosity to others. Lord, support and bring relief to those affected in Alabama by the tornado this week. Jesus, bring comfort to those who mourn and full recovery to those who are injured. We pray for peace for India amongst the violence between India and China border, and also fighting in New Delhi. Lord God, as people fight one another, we know we also fight a deadly virus. We continue to lift up the United Kingdom, all that are sick, vulnerable, or have succumbed to COVID-19. In all places where there isn't yet enough vaccine, help us be model citizens of your kingdom as followers of Jesus, praying for all vulnerable to the pandemic and supporting those who minister directly to them. We pray, our Lord, for the losses in our community and beyond, not only by the virus, but from other ailments. Comfort those who mourn, bring strength and love where weakness and fear try to consume them. We pray for our mission partner, Plant with Purpose, especially for the staff along with the family of Kirsty as they grieve her sudden death. We are called your people of hope and faith. We believe in the resurrection and in knowing, Lord Jesus, that through you we live forever. Our prayers we give as a sacrifice of love and trust as we pray together the Lord's Prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you. Greetings. Let us begin our time in the scripture with a prayer for illumination. Please join me in prayer. God, source of all light, by your word you give light to the soul. Pour out on us the spirit of wisdom and understanding, that our hearts and our minds may be opened. Amen. And now, a reading from the book of Zechariah. So on behalf of the sheep merchants, I became the shepherd of the flock, doomed to be slaughtered. I took two staffs, one I named Favor, and the other I named Unity. And I tended to the sheep. In 1 month, I disposed of three shepherds, for I had become impatient with them, and they also despised me. So I said, I will not be your shepherd. What is to die, let it die. What is to be destroyed, let it be destroyed, and let those that are left devour the flesh of one another. I took my staff Favor and broke it, annulling the covenant that I had made with all the peoples. So it was annulled on that day, and the sheep merchants who were watching me knew that it was the word of the Lord. I then said to them, if it seems right to you, give me my wages, but if not, keep them. So they weighed out my wages, 30 shekels of silver. Then the Lord said to me, throw it into the treasury, this lordly price at which I was valued to them. So I took the 30 shekels of silver and threw them into the treasury in the house of the Lord. Then I broke the second staff Unity, annulling the family ties between Judah and Israel. Now a reading from the letter to the Romans. For in one body we have many members, and not all the members have the same function. So we, who are many, are one body in Christ, and individually we are members of one of another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us. The word of the Lord.
We must all hang together, or surely we will all hang separately. Benjamin Franklin said that to the Continental Congress meeting in Philadelphia just before the signing of the Declaration of Independence. I have been going back into the beginnings of our nation to find some wisdom, some guidance, some inspiration about what America's all about. And even more so, I've been going back into the Holy Scriptures to find some similar wisdom, inspiration, and guidance for how to live through the current crisis that you and I are living in. We have a crisis that began nearly a year ago now, a medical crisis, if you will, the pandemic. Enough said about that. We have a crisis in our culture that's been with us for hundreds of years now, the crisis of racism and the larger issues of justice and equality for all people in these United States. We have a crisis in our political system. Anybody with any knowledge at all about what's going on in the world understands that. We are using this crisis season as an opportunity to grow and to learn and to get better at not just being citizens, but being Christians, people who follow Jesus. There's nothing new about that. There's nothing new about crisis, and there's nothing new about the dynamic of people going back into the scriptures, back into the wisdom, back into the history and truth of our faith to teach us what we need to know in order to live through this current crisis. And so we last week began a new series of messages that I've entitled The Way of Jesus in a Wayward World. We're looking at the 12th chapter of Romans. In Paul's letter to the Romans, he's talked about just how lost the whole world is, especially the world of humanity, but how God has done something about that by sending his son Jesus to be with us, to save us, and then to show us a new way of life. And that's what we're focusing on, that new way of life. Paul says that we are meant to be transformed into creatures who live as our Creator intended for us, as modeled and taught and made possible by Jesus. We are not to be conformed to this world, but we are meant to live differently. And then Paul begins to describe what different human life is like, what actually successful human life is all about. He began his list by talking about humility. Humility towards God, which says, God, we don't know and understand, but we're going to follow your way. And then humility with others, because we're all in the same boat. Paul continues the conversation, and that's what we'll focus on today, by looking at unity. Unity. Unity, or another word for it, community. I'll ask a question this week, like I asked last week. Why does Paul put unity and community so high on his list of those things that are necessary for us to incorporate and to live by as transformed creatures in the world? Was it because he was writing to a bunch of strong-willed folks who lived in Rome and ran the universe and they needed to learn how to cooperate with each other? Was it because he was writing to the Roman church, this tiny little group of people who were completely insignificant as far as the rest of the world was concerned, but in Paul's mind, God was doing something through the life of the church that was eventually going to change the whole world, and the only way that they would get it done is by staying united with each other, by becoming and remaining a community. I think those are a couple of good reasons that Paul thought that unity and community was so important in the life of the early church. But I also happen to think that Paul understood human history, especially through the lens of the history of the Jewish people. He understood that unity and community is a huge problem for us. A few moments ago, we heard a short passage from the Old Testament prophet Zechariah. Let's look at what Zechariah had to say for just a couple of moments. Zechariah prophesied beginning around the year 520 before Jesus. Zechariah prophesied as some of the Jewish people were coming back from their exile in Babylon and beginning to settle again in their ancient homeland in the area of Palestine, in Israel. And the people were having a hard time getting along with each other. Some of the Jews had been left in Israel, and now others were coming back after decades of being gone, and they were having a hard time getting along with each other. Even more so, though, the Jews had experienced through their whole history a problem. The problem of staying unified as a people, the problem of being a community with each other. If you think about the long history of the Jewish people, they began, of course, as one family, the family of Abraham. That family grew, but eventually found itself enslaved in Egypt. And then they were released from their slavery, and in their newfound freedom, they wandered in the wilderness. They eventually moved into a new territory, and the 12 tribes eventually were confederated together. They became a powerful and wealthy nation, but not long after, all the different rivalries and dissensions and difficulties began to start again. The nation declined, the nation disintegrated, the nation went into exile. Zechariah in a rather confusing passage, admittedly. Zechariah talked about the things that are necessary in human life in order for people to be successful with each other, in order to have lives of peace and prosperity. And he brings up an amazing image, the image of a shepherd who has two staffs. One of those staffs is the staff of favor or a covenant relationship with God. The other staff is a staff of unity or community relationships with each other. Zechariah, as all the people of his time, and frankly the people of our time, try to understand why it is that we do not have those things in our human world. And so Zechariah pictures the shepherd breaking the staff of favor, breaking the staff of unity, as a way of saying that because of people's disobedience to God and to each other, everything is broken. Everything is destroyed. What interests me is why Zechariah would pick out those two things, favor with God and unity with each other, as the most important things for us to have. Favor with God is one way of talking about having a relationship with God. Zechariah well knew, the Jewish people well knew, that they had to maintain a covenant relationship with God. They had to stay unified with God if they were going to succeed. They also knew that they had to have unity with each other, community with each other, if they were going to succeed. And they had experienced in their history that in those times when they turned away from God and when they turned away from each other, things did not go well. Interesting that when Jesus talked about the greatest commandment, he put two things together. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. That's the same thing Zechariah is talking about, loving God and loving each other. And so I have to think that Paul, as he thought of the advice, the wisdom that he wanted to share with the Christians in Rome and then with Christians everywhere, because of course Paul's words are Holy Scripture, Paul went back to that deep understanding that had been forged over many, many centuries of the life of the Jewish people, an understanding that said that the only way that things actually work for all of us or for any of us is when we are in relationship with God and with each other. In the first 11 chapters of his letter to the Romans, Paul has talked about how it is we have that relationship with God. And now he's talking about how we have that relationship with each other, with first humility and then unity. So let's talk about unity some more today. Let me make a few observations. Is there more that could be said? Of course. But these things, I think, are at least important. Number one, we need to admit that unity among people, or community, is a fundamental human problem. It's not unique in our time. It's not unique to Christians or Jews, but it's a human problem. Think about the very first family, the first family, Adam and Eve, and then Cain and Abel. Now, we have not heard anything in the scripture, and we never will, about the nature of the marriage between Adam and Eve. But we have heard about the relationship that their two children experienced, and it wasn't good. From the very beginning, human beings have experienced a problem in getting along with each other. And so the problem of unity and community is not new. It's not limited to the Judeo-Christian tradition. Let's admit that, but then let's move on. Here's another observation that I'll make, and that is that unity and community is actually the major story of human history. It's the big story. Now, I know as you tune in to the evening news or open the morning newspaper or open a history book that most of what history talks about is how people have not gotten along with each other. We often mark our periods of history by talking about the wars that we've had. Well, such and such happened during the Vietnam War or World War II or World War I. And so you would think that the lack of community and the lack of unity in human history is the big story, but it's actually not. It is the exception. The real story of human history is the fact that things really only work when we are unified with each other. A marriage between two people works only when they find a way to forge a community with each other. A family works only when that family finds a way to be unified in some sense. And the principle goes all the way up the chain, if you will. The workplace only works with community. The military only works if people are unified. Our businesses only work if people are united together. The big story is how most of the time, most people find a way in some way, shape, or form, not perfectly, of course, but they find a way to be together. If you don't trust me, if you don't trust the words of Scripture, then maybe you'll trust somebody like Vince Lombardi, who said that you should build for your team, football team is what he was talking about, of course, you should build for your team a feeling of oneness, of dependence on one another, and of strength to be derived by unity. If you don't like football coaches, let me give you a word from Henry Ford. Henry Ford said that coming together is a beginning, keeping together is progress, and working together is success. And of course, Henry Ford's little car company is still doing okay, aren't they? If you don't trust Vince or Henry, then let me share these words for you from Adrian Cronauer. Who? Who's Adrian Cronauer? Maybe some of you know, but I doubt that many of you do. Adrian Cronauer was a disc jockey in the Air Force, stationed in Vietnam. He had a very popular radio show that became the inspiration for a movie starring Robin Williams called Good Morning Vietnam. Adrian Cronauer was an American patriot, and he once said that our flag is not just one of many political points of view. Rather, the flag is a symbol of our national unity. Do you remember that our flag has 13 stripes that stand for the original 13 colonies that found a way to be unified with each other? Do you remember that we have 50 stars on that flag that stands for the 50 states that are meant to be unified with each other? Things only work when we are unified with each other. Another observation. Unity is very easy to achieve at some level if you find a way to blame other people and create enemies out of other people. That's right. It's very easy to get a small group of people together by saying that everybody else is your enemy. When I was in high school, involved in high school athletics, we had amazing rivalries with teams from other towns. But then, once a year, the best players from those basketball and football teams were brought together for an all-star game, and you suddenly realized that there were other people who had been on those teams that were your mortal enemies, but now they were your friends. You took towns like Socorro and Silver City and Tularosa from the south, and then you put them against towns from Belen or Albuquerque Academy or Santa Fe, and you pitted the north against the south. All of a sudden, you discovered that your enemies were now meant to be your friends. North-south, That was another issue, but the principle is the same. You see, it's easy to achieve unity by saying that somebody else is our enemy. Let's fight against them. But that doesn't work very well for the long term, because ultimately you end up still just fighting. And that leads me to a fourth observation, that true unity, true community, as it is envisioned in Scripture and modeled by Jesus, is something that incorporates diversity and one day will incorporate the whole world. Paul often talked about the human body, and he refers to that here in this passage of Romans, how different parts of the body must come together to form one whole. Paul sometimes talks about a family or a building, all the things that we experience in life that have different parts that must come together. He will continue that conversation as we move further on in the 12th chapter of Romans. But let's just note that for now, the only unity and community that really works long term is not the unity brought just for some by having a common enemy, but the unity that works for all as we are all brought together. Somerset Maugham, the great English writer, once said that the essence of the beautiful is unity in variety. The essence of the beautiful is unity in variety. Indeed. A fifth observation. Our unity is required. It is fundamental if we are to survive with each other. Long time ago, I read a true story about a man who was on a transoceanic cruise. He was on a cargo ship, and I think it was the captain had this big dog, kind of a mean dog, and the man and the dog didn't get along very well with each other, but there was a storm and the ship sank, and the man found himself on a small life raft with the dog. It was just him and the dog. Everything else was lost. Everyone else was lost. They were adrift at sea for days, and finally a ship appeared on the horizon and went sailing by, and the man began to yell and scream and try to get the attention of the ship, but his voice was not strong enough. And so the dog started barking and baying. And the dog had a strong enough voice. And someone on that passing ship heard and noticed. And it was the dog who saved the man's life and his own. After that, they were fast friends. You see, ultimately, we need each other every one, if we are going to survive and thrive on this planet. Another observation, the great leaders of history are judged by how great they have been at bringing unity. King David, the greatest king of Israel, was judged as a great king because he brought 12 tribes together into a confederation. George Washington, one of the great presidents of American history, arguably still the greatest, was the one who united the colonies together and almost by acclamation was chosen as the first president. Abraham Lincoln, another of our great presidents, judged favorably because he held the Union together. But you don't have to go into American history. Go further into the history of our faith. Jesus, who brought 12 men together from different backgrounds, different socioeconomic status, and through them created a small community that became a worldwide movement that still is growing. And that takes me to my last observation, that what God intended to do through Jesus was to create a community of people, the church, who would model for the rest of the world what a community is supposed to be, who would model for the rest of the world how we can be united with each other. At first, some of Jesus' followers thought that the community was only for the Jews, but then they began to realize it was also for the Gentiles, for all people. And they began to remember what Jesus had said, that if a kingdom is divided against itself, it cannot stand. If the worldwide community is divided against itself, it cannot stand. And so our unity must begin in the church, in the village church, as we stay together, as the red side and the blue side and the purple side and whatever other colors you want to pick, stay together. And then we model the unity that God wants for all of his people. I have to think that Jesus' words were in the back of the minds of three strong leaders who in 1776 proposed a motto for the Great Seal of the brand new United States. Benjamin Franklin, John Adams, and Thomas Jefferson, united together, said that the motto for our nation should be this: E pluribus unum. From the many, one. You see, friends, there is so much in our history as American Christians. There is so much more in our history simply as Christians, regardless of which country we happen to be citizens of. So much that teaches us who we are meant to be and how we are meant to live. Unity, community, is the only way to go. It's the way of Jesus in a wayward world. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Jack, for bringing us the message this morning. Let us join together as we affirm our faith from Colossians 1. Jesus Christ is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in him all things in heaven and on earth were created, things visible and invisible. Whether thrones or dominions or rulers or powers, all things have been created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him God was pleased to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of his cross.
We are called to be God.
We began our worship together with ancient words from the Psalms that affirmed how good and pleasant it is when kindred dwell in unity. What are you doing to create community with others around you? What are we doing together to model that community and live it out so that others can see the blessedness, the beauty, the power, the joy that come from being one with each other? It's not easy, but it's our calling as we follow Jesus. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and bring you his peace today and always. Amen.